worship and exalt the Lord our God. Just a couple of announcements to share before we begin our service this morning. I invite you to use your Church Center app to share your prayer requests, learn more about upcoming events, and check out the small groups that are available and when they meet. For your regular giving, you can use the boxes out in the lobby or use the Church Center app. Later in the service, you will meet and hear from today's guest speaker, Rodney Wright from Pure Desire Ministries. Please note that in lieu of our regular benevolence offering, that a special offering will be taken at the rear doors at the end of the service for Rodney and Tracy and the work that they're doing with Pure Desire Ministries. You were invited to join us for the Community Youth Worship's spring musical, Cross the World. This musical will feature music, drama, and dance from around the world and remind us that everyone needs Jesus. Amen. This event is this Friday, May 6th at 7 p.m. right here in the sanctuary. It's free, it's fun, and it's family friendly. You don't find that around very often anymore, folks. So come and support the Community Youth Worship Spring Musical. Ladies, the next coffee break is coming Thursday, May 12th at 7 p.m. Now, I have not been to a women's coffee break, but Joan, my wife, shares that it is a wonderful opportunity for fellowship and encouraging one another. Also, at this coffee break, this coming coffee break, you will hear how God saved a sister in Christ from her old life and how he's using her life now to help others deepen their walk with him. You will not want to miss this coffee break. Well, it is estimated that 5 to 8% of adults are addicted to pornography. And the upcoming Men's Conquer series is a powerful boot camp style study to help men conquer pornography and other unwanted sexual behaviors. This transformative 10-part series starts Monday, May 16th at 7 p.m. in the firehouse. Our missionary of the week is Lois Osborne, serving with Kenya Evangelical Mission. There's a couple praises that I would like to share with you that she has shared with us. Number one, earlier this month, we dedicated the New Victory Church on Sunday with about 600 people and our senator and other government officials. They said that Kenya Evangelical Mission is the biggest ministry in our country. It is marvelous what God has done and the hundreds that have been saved. She also shares that we praise God for Redwood Chapel that has helped make this happen. So thank you, those of you who faithfully give to support our missionaries around the world. A couple prayer requests that she also shares. And she states, inflation is, everybody know about inflation? Have you, raise your hand if inflation has made an impact on you. Come on, get those hands up. Inflation is hitting the mission field just like everywhere else, and we are all struggling. Some of us are struggling to get medicine. This is shared by Lois. She states, my doctor just added 3 new medicines that cost $220 a month, and Kenya does not have price controls. She also asks us to pray for the director of the children's home, as well as some of the children who are experiencing a bad cold flu. Would you join me in prayer this morning? Heavenly Father, what a wonderful day that you've given to us. May we truly rejoice in our hearts for what you have done for us. Father, we want to lift up Lois Osborne to you. Father, we're so thankful for the dedication of the Victory Church here recently, for the testimony that they can share with their community, for the hundreds of people and more who have been saved through that ministry. Father, we also just thank you, Father, for this body of believers that has in its DNA to support missionaries around the world, that the gospel may be spread. Father, we want to lift up Lois to you. Father, as they struggle with inflation, Father, you are the God who fed so many with just a few loaves and fishes, and you are the great God who can meet any need that our missionaries or that we have. Father, we also want to pray for the director of the children's home there in Kenya. Father, would you help him as well as the children's that are down with this cold flu? Father, we just pray for healing. And that, Father, you would restore their bodies that they could get back to the work that they're doing. Father, we just pray for our service this morning. Father, that you would be glorified and exalted. Receive our worship. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen.
Amen. Yep. Thank you, Mike. So good to be back with you. I was in the horrible state of Idaho. I'm not supposed to say the I word. I realize that. But I was there. But everybody said, did you look at houses? And it's like, yeah, as I drove by in my car. But no, we're not going anywhere. We're staying here. We love Redwood too much. So going to be with you guys. So I'm glad to be back. We want to praise God today. This is a Jesus-loving church. So let's stand and sing to our Savior this morning. Think about the cross.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior long. That cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah. Oh,
So look to him.
There is strength within the sorrow. There is beauty in our tears. And you meet us in our mourning with a love that casts out fear. You are working in our waiting. You're sanctifying us. When beyond our understanding, you're teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. You are wisdom.
turn it for our good. You turn it for our good and for your glory. Even in the valley, you are faithful. You're working for our good. You're working for our good and for your glory. Even what the enemy means for evil, you turn. You know, I think most of us want to love Jesus more. Amen? How do you do that? Here's a suggestion from me. Think about what you've been forgiven, how much you've been forgiven, and the fact that God holds none of that on your plate any longer. It's washed away. And you're standing there this morning, a clean vessel before God. You were guilty, and now your sins are gone. Think about that, and you'll love Jesus more. And we'll sing together. Guilty, I'm guilty, was all that I could say. Mercy, your mercy, crashing like a wave, and all my sin was washed away, washed away. You took them all, there's not a trace. I stand here free with every stain.
But the blood of Jesus.
and all my sins were washed away.
Sure does mine, but we are going to pick it up a little bit.
Sing up there.
I always wanted to finish a song by jumping on the downbeat and seeing if I could make that happen, but I know I'd mess it up, so I don't want to do that. So God bless you guys. Go ahead and have a seat. Thank you so much for leading us in worship this morning, singing about victory, singing about Jesus covering over our sins, singing about sovereignty, the sovereignty of God that is over us. These are great and beautiful themes, and we want to continue to lean into that idea. Kids, if you're in grades 1 through 3, this is your opportunity to head off to Kids Church. You can walk your way down the aisle and make your way over to see Mrs. Larson, who will take you to our Kids Center. And parents, you'll remember that would be helpful for us if you picked up your kids at the end of the service and took them home with you, because they're yours, not ours. And we love them, but we don't want to keep them. So it'd be really great. Hey, we have a guest speaker with us this morning who I want to introduce you to. Rodney Wright is here. He's actually here with his wife, Tracy, because they're going to be with us again this evening together. But Rodney was a pastor for a number of years. He grew up actually in the Central Valley. I think you said, Rodney, born in Salinas and raised in the Modesto area, was called into pastoral ministry and was an executive pastor and helped to plant a church a number of years ago. And about 5 years ago, began to work with a ministry called Pure Desire Ministries. And Pure Desire Ministries simply seeks to help families and churches create a healthy culture around the topic of sexuality. And Rodney and his wife Tracy together wrote a book called How to Talk to Your Kids About Sex, which we have available for you in the lobby. They're also hosting a parent seminar this evening on this very topic, which I'll tell you a little bit more about at the very end of the service. But would you do me a favor and welcome to the stage our speaker this morning, Rodney Wright. God bless you, bud.
Thank you so much, Jeff. Okay.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you. Honored to be here. Well, good morning, everyone. So glad to be here and so glad to see so many of so many different ages. I think it's a wonderful thing. And I love that you do the announcements at the beginning of church. Way to go. You got it figured out here at Redwood Chapel. That's fantastic. Well, I'm privileged to be with you today. Like Jeff said, my name is Rodney. And my wife Tracy and I are here with you today, and we live in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. How many of you have ever heard about that? All your friends are moving up there. I send them back down to you guys. I tell you what, being from California, you can take the boy out of California, but you can't take California out of the boy. Can I get an amen? Yeah. I love this state right here. And glad to be with you here today. I know some of you are probably thinking, I never thought we would have a sexual missionary in church here today. This should be pretty interesting, you know. Guy's going to talk about human sexuality. But I think it's long overdue, in my opinion, that the Christian faith and the religious culture learn how to integrate healthy communication and resource parents to know how to have age-appropriate conversations with their kids about human sexuality. I don't know who trained your great-grandparents to talk to grandma and grandpa, and I don't know who trained grandma and grandpa to talk to your parents, and I don't know who talked to your parents to talk to you, but I know this, when we wrote our book, How to Talk with Your Kids About Sex, my son said to me, Dad, I wish you would have bought this book when I was a little boy. I said, me too. I wish somebody would have given us a framework to know how to have these conversations. How many know we cannot let culture anymore be the educator of our children in this arena? The church has to speak its voice. So this is why I just want to say, Jeff and Pastor Corey and Pastor Sherry and Kayla, and all, just thank your team so much and your leadership team to bringing us in so that we can help resource you, to give you tools and resources to know how to help the future generation. How many think our kids are worth it? They're so worth it. They are so, so worth that. That's worth clapping. How many think our kids are worth it? Yeah. Speaking of kids, Tracy and I have three. Our daughter Whitney's married, and our two sons, Austin and Keaton, they're 30, 29, and 25. And I have our first grandchild, Louie Lee Zabidio. How's that? Louie Lee Zabidio. Nice Italian name. He's either going to be in the mafia, or he's going to be an Italian singer, or maybe a great Italian chef. But Louis is something else. And if you meet me back at the table, I'll show you pictures for an hour of my grandson. How many would say you got the cutest grandkids God ever made? You're here today. Okay, yeah. You've heard the one guy said, I've seen the lights of Paris, and I've seen the lights of Rome. But the greatest lights I've ever seen are my kids' tail lights taking my grandkids home. You can spoil them and then send them off. Amen, Grandma and Grandpa. Spoil them and send them off. Well, I'm not talking about all that, but I just got a little excited here today. Let's get into scriptures here today. And if you would open your Bible to Genesis chapter 1 or look on the screen, it'll be there for us. Now, I'm not going to have time to go through the whole Bible today. But I want to start right here. And I know that just speaking about this subject matter in this context with different ages, we want to use appropriate language in communicating about this. But tonight, when you come to our parent training, we're really going to talk about human sexuality in a way that I think will be so helpful for mom and dad or grandparents or any ages. And we encourage the high schoolers to come because we want to coach you up so that you can be a healthy parent when you start your relationship and your marriage. And so we'd like you to come there. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The word God in this scripture was written in the Hebrew language. And the word God means Elohim. Can you say that with me? Elohim. They speak Hebrew in Castro Valley. I knew they were smarter than us in the San Joaquin Valley for sure. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. The word God here is used singular. There's one God, Elohim. If you come down to verse 26, Elohim now speaks. Then Elohim, God said, let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness. So Elohim created in his own image. In the image of Elohim, God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. So interesting. Elohim, this singular God, speaks and says this, let us create man in our image and our likeness. Now, for those of us that are a part of historical Christianity, in the fourth century, they coined this phrase, the early church fathers, was that God was one being in relationship, God the Father, God the Son, and God the three in one. This is where the doctrine of the Trinity really was given some language where we could understand that God, at God's core, is relational. At God's core, Father, Son, and Spirit. And we read this through the scriptures. Now, to me, this is a miracle. This is one doctrine in historical Christianity that Catholics, Orthodox, and Protestants all agree upon. How many know that's a miracle in itself right there? We would all agree on one doctrine, that God is relational at their core. And the early church fathers, when they talked about the Trinity, they said things like this. That God is mutually indwelling Father, Son, and Spirit without losing their distinctiveness. The three are one. Three are one. This is the image we get in marriage, where the scripture says a man will leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the what? The two shall become. So human sexuality, mutually indwelling physically without losing their distinctiveness. Still husband, still wife, still male, still female. Beautiful. And historical Christianity always believed that you can't split God. That God is one being in this beautiful relationship together. And that you and I were made in their image. And then it says that God made in their image Adam and Eve, male and female. Now, Jesus really affirmed the Trinity when he said things like this. It was kind of crazy language. It's what got Jesus killed. When he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Elohim? Jesus said things like in John, the Father and I are one. Paul says in Colossians, writing about Jesus, he's the visible image of the invisible God, and the fullness of the Godhead dwells in him. This was mind-boggling in the Jewish culture. Are you telling us you're one with Elohim? And the angel said to the shepherds, you will call his name Emmanuel, for he is God with us. God came in our condition. I love that we were singing about it today. The music was so good. I love a church that has a cowbell. That's awesome. And Jeff and I were both feeling the same thing on that lick on the guitar. It was great. Jesus, let me just say this. If you take nothing away today, take this. Jesus didn't come to save us from God. Jesus came to reveal God as Savior. Someone needs to hear that today. God has nothing but your best interest, because God is exactly like Jesus. I can tell we got a lot of Jesus fans here in the crowd. Aren't you glad that when we want to know what God is like, Jesus is that representative? God is exactly like Jesus. Safe. Nothing but our best interest. The Trinity gather around. They create man first, male. They think, what could we use? Oh, yeah, dirt. This will be perfect. They grab some dirt. They blow into it. And they created Adam. I could just see the Trinity stepping back and all in one saying this word, hey, I think we can do better than this. Some theologians believe that had the Trinity created Eve first, us men would have never been created. God would have stopped right there and just said, you know what? I think it's not going to get any better than this. Let's just cap it right here. Any women in the house here today, ladies? I know what you're thinking. We should invite Rodney back on Mother's Day. This guy's amazing. But the Bible says male and female both were made in the image of God. We're both image bearers of God. In fact, you want to know what God may look like? Just find a woman in the audience today. Go ahead, look around. There's a bunch of them here. Turn your neck. Find a woman. She is an image bearer of God. Can I get an amen? This is what I love about Jesus. He was in a culture where women were less than, and he was always elevating women's worth and value. So beautiful. We're both made in the image of God. And we both reflect that beautiful image. And then God, the scripture says, God blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply. This is one of those things I think we need to help our children understand, is that when God made you, he didn't make a mistake. And your maleness and your femaleness is a gift from God. And we both reflect the image of God. And then as you read through this passage, it says God blessed them. And I wish I had time to unpack that, but I don't. I got to keep going. And then it said that God said, be fruitful and multiply. In the Message version, it says, light a candle and get jazz music. That's a different translation of the scripture. And our humanity, our human sexuality, the ability to bond with another person, the ability to feel immense pleasure, and the ability to create other human beings. God gave us that in the gift of human sexuality. And sexuality at its highest level, that's best, is in a committed relationship, male and female. What we call in our culture is marriage, where we say, I'm all in, honey. All of me to all of you for the rest of my life. And it's wonderful. Well, I know this firsthand, that when relationships or sexuality is going well, it can be heaven on earth. Can I get an amen on that one? Strategic nerve endings, my kind of God, way to go. You'll get that later. Some of you will get that on the way home today. But also, when relationships or human sexuality isn't going well, it can be a hell, living hell on earth. I know that firsthand, too. Let me tell you a little bit about my story. I was born in Salinas, as Jeff said. My father was almost 40 years old when I was born. I was the youngest of five children. So I wasn't like a welcomed gift. I was like, uh-oh, good Lord, what are we doing? We got another one. My parents were loving and caring. My father was an Assembly of God pastor. He left the church in Salinas, church of about 500 in that day, came to Modesto and built a large church in the 70s, about 1,500 adults that came on the weekend in the 70s. Had 21 red, white, and blue buses that he went and picked up kids all over town and brought them to church. Never forget it. So I was raised in church. I used to say to my mom, church, church, church. That's all we ever do is go to church. Because those days it seemed like we went 4 days a week to church. If I could describe my dad to you, we were just with him in Modesto. My dad is a cross between Billy Graham, Ronald Reagan, and 10% John Wayne. That's my dad. You got a visual on that guy? He was winsome. He had deep faith in God, and he had a whole lot of grit in him. And if he were here today at 94, he said it just 2 days ago, he said, Rod, I'd be on the front row saying, go get him, Rod. Talk about this, because we didn't know how to talk about this back in my day. Well, when I was 16, this Billy Graham, Ronald Reagan, John Wayne guy, I didn't think my dad ever made a mistake or ever sinned. In fact, vulnerability wasn't really vogue in those days. You just faked it till you made it. How do you know what I'm talking about? And so I remember saying to my mom when I was 16, has dad ever sinned? I literally asked my mom that question. Has dad ever sinned? And you know what my mom said? Oh, hon, I assure you, your father has sinned. As every wife can say amen to that. The scripture says we have all sinned. It's a condition that we're all born with. Amen? We all need help. I just wanted to make sure I wasn't adopted or something, you know. So when I was a young boy and I was first exposed to pornography, I didn't know how to process that in my brain. I didn't know how to talk about that with my mom and dad or in my religious culture. Now, I'm old. I'm an old person. So the pornography I saw was chiseled on a rock. I mean, that's how old I am. We didn't have these devices in our pockets that all the kids have today. I was an old man. And as I was a young boy, I didn't know how to process that, and I didn't have any framework to understand that not all of my sexual feelings are bad or evil. Some of that's a normal part of my adolescent development. But if mismanaged and misguided, it could be very destructive in my life. So I didn't know. So I remember talking to my brother, who was 20 months older than me, Ryan, and said, Ryan, this is a problem for me, and this is what's happening in my life, and I would feel guilt and shame. And at the end of the service, we would come down to an altar like this, and I would be so sincere at 16 and 17 and say to God, God, I'm so sorry I did this. And I would pray for an hour. I would cry. I would promise God, I'll never do that again. Anybody say a prayer like that before? I'll never do that again. And then I would pledge to not do it again. And I would purge by confessing. And I would get up, and I was convinced I would never do it again. I continued on this journey. I didn't think I had a compulsive problem or an addiction, because in our line of thinking, in our theology, Christians couldn't have addictions. That's what those other pagans had, not us people that were religious. I went to a Bible school in the Deep South, studying to be a pastor. The auditorium, this kind of reminds me of it here, Jeff. And this Bible school was ran by a famous TV preacher who traveled all over the world filling stadiums with like 100,000 people. And in my opinion, he took the message of Jesus, just my opinion, you don't have to agree, but dumbed it down to hell insurance. Say this prayer so you won't go to hell when you die. And that was the totality of the message. Say this prayer so you won't go to hell. Meanwhile, this famous TV preacher in the 80s was living in his own hell of sexual addiction. And I remember, 18 years old, when he gets on stage and says, I have sinned. 7,000 people in the building. I was sitting right up there next to my girlfriend Tracy of the balcony. And I remember thinking this, hey, there are two of us. There are two of us sinning, you and me. And I thought as a young man, you know what, he's going to flip the script, and in faith communities now, we're going to start having honest conversations about sexuality. He's going to talk about how he got misguided, and he's going to help all of us young students begin to learn and grow and go a different direction. But you know what? And I say this not in a condemning way of him, but a sad way. It wasn't safe to have those kind of conversations in those days. And so we never heard about it again. Until the next time he struggled. So I thought to myself as a young man, well, if I have this problem with human sexuality, I'll get married. Because the only scripture I could remember about the Bible is better to marry and burn. How's that for a foundation to build a marriage? And here's what I thought as a young man. If I have this problem, I'll get married and marriage will fix it. How many know if you have a problem, just get married, it'll fix it? And this is what I learned, that marriage doesn't change you, it just reveals more of what it finds in you. If marriage finds you healthy, let me say this to all the students here. If marriage finds you healthy in an area of your life, guess what? It's going to reveal your health. If it finds you unhealthy, it's going to reveal that unhealth. And it did. And this didn't change. So as a young boy, I was confessing to my brother. I was confessing to my father even, and his love and acceptance, thinking, if I pray long, if I cry, if I read scripture, if I confess, God, I don't know what other levers to pull to find some freedom in my life. One TV preacher that I watched, anybody here ever watch people, preachers on TV besides me? Oh, you know, it's not a trick question. It's okay, yeah. One preacher said if I sent him $50, all my problems would be gone. Man, I couldn't find my checkbook fast enough. It's a pretty good deal. $50, sent that thing in the mail. And I'm going to call him now and ask for a large donation for Pure Desire Ministries. Doing everything I could. Young pastor, 25 years ago, I said, God, I don't know what else to do, but I'm not transforming in this area of my life. I'm confessing, I'm praying. I thought I was repenting, and I'll talk about that in just a second. And I remember I was sitting on a Sunday morning on the front row where the Holy Spirit kind of shined a light on the drummer playing the drums in church that day. Now, I noticed your drummer, you keep him in a cage back here, right here. I don't know his whole story, but he's caged in here. And I felt the Holy Spirit say to me as a young man, Rodney, go to that drummer. He's going to help you. And I thought, I'm not going to that drummer. Because his line of work was a sexual trauma assessment treatment therapist. If I go to him, that means I'm messed up. And I felt like the Trinity all said at once, you're messed up, Rod. But we fully anticipated the 80s. And you have not taken us by surprise. And we have people and resources ready for you. Thank you for taking this step of faith. I went to this counselor. I went in on a Tuesday hoping to be fixed by Friday, so I was all fixed by Sunday. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. I wanted the quick character fix instead of doing the hard work of working through my negative sexual history and grieving and processing and working through some of my traumas. And what started as, I hope, a one-week visit for $70 turned into a three-year journey of writing checks all the time for $70. And I began to watch my life change. This next slide I want to put on the screen here. I used to think life is a little bit like this. Life has a lot of different components to it. This is just an example. Life has work and school and hobbies and church and devotion and friends and finances and emotions and sexuality. Life has a lot of components to it, doesn't it? And I used to think growing up in faith that the spiritual part of Rodney was this. I was spiritual when I went to church or I did my devotions. So this is what my spiritual life looked like, the part in the blue. So I used to think when I go to church and I do my devotions or sing to God, that's the spiritual part of Rodney, and all this other part is non-spiritual, right? This is what we call segregation. We segregate parts of our life. So I thought the goal of the Christian life was to see how many church services you can come in a week. It was to see how long you could pray. It was to see how long you could, how much money, it was all about that. It wasn't about learning how to integrate the way of Jesus in all areas of life. So my therapist helped me with a term called holistic spirituality. Now, that's not a New Age term. It's the term that Jesus said when he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Jesus was inviting us to allow God to help all areas of your life. Or like Paul said, whatever you do in word or in deed, do all as unto the Lord. And so my therapist would say, Rodney, you're just thinking that you're spiritual here, but you never learned how to integrate the way of God in your emotions and traumas you had as a young boy, in your human sexuality. You've never learned how to integrate health in those areas, but we're going to help you. And so I begin to say, God, I don't want to just pray more or read more scripture. How do I take the truth of scripture and integrate that into these areas of my life in a healthy way? And this began a journey for me of transformation 25 years ago. I'm on that road to recovery. I've had decades of sobriety. But more than just sobriety, I'm learning how to be emotionally healthy and emotionally present to my wife and children. Aren't you glad for that? Can someone say amen to that? I'm not just stopping a bad behavior. I'm learning how to integrate the way of God in all areas of life. That's why I love voices like Dave Ramsey, who's helping the church and culture learn how to integrate the way of God in finances, right? So we started a church in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, 20 years ago. It really grew. A buddy of mine, Joe, who was in AA for 20 years, got saved and said, hey, at the end of a Celebrate Recovery graduation, said, Rod, what are we doing about pornography and the problem with that in culture? And I said, well, you know, my wife and I teach a class, Understanding and Managing Your Sexuality. This was about 8 years ago. And he said to me, will you come to a Pure Desire training to hear Dr. Ted Roberts talk about their ministry? And I felt that same prompting of the Holy Spirit that I felt about the drummer. It was the invitation of God. Rodney, do you want to participate in what we're doing to heal people in this area? You know, here's what I've come to believe. God doesn't want to use us. Is anyone here? You don't have to raise your hand. Just think about it. Has anybody here ever been used by somebody? Doesn't feel real good, does it? I'm grateful that God's not a user. But what God does, I believe, is he always invites us to participate with. And we always get a choice, yes or no. And I remember going, and it was the first time when I listened to Dr. Ted Roberts, our founder of Pure Desire, talk about Pure Desire Ministries and how it's resourcing churches to start groups for men and women who struggle with unwanted sexual behavior, and not just to stop the behavior, but get down to the core root, the wound, and learn how to manage that as well. And maybe you're here today, and like me, you understand negative sexual history. Maybe it's an addiction, an affair, an abortion. Maybe it's all kinds of abuse that's happened to you. Those are all those things sometimes that we're so afraid of and don't know where to talk and process those things. And Pure Desire has group materials for men and women to get help. And the spouse who's been betrayed, there's groups for them where they can come and grieve and process the hurt. I said, this is great. I heard Dr. Ted talk about three things. Talked about the neuroscience of the brain and how the brain has neurons that fire off and create synapses. And with pornography, it floods the brain with dopamine, and they create these synapses, these connections in the brain that become strong, and that neurons that fire together, wire together. So the repetitiveness of this, it kind of becomes unconscious, your ability to be triggered and move into this kind of behavior. And he was talking about the neuroscience of the brain. And then he was saying this, most of our addictive behaviors are coping mechanisms because we don't know how to process and grieve painful experiences. And I believe that. I've been doing grief work in Coeur d'Alene for 20 years. We've seen thousands of men and women go through our grief work because they can just learn how to grieve. You know, when you have loss in life, your grief isn't what's wrong with you. It's actually what's right with you. It's the appropriate emotional response to loss. And when we help people grieve, we really give them a gift. And then he said, here's how you retrain the brain. And in the neuroscience, they call that neuroplasticity. How many have heard of that word, neuroplasticity? The brain can change. And the biblical word for neuroplasticity is repentance. It's changing how you think. That's the word for repentance. I used to think repentance was coming down here, pastor, and crying at an altar and just being sorry. Well, I was sorry, but I didn't know how to identify my thinking error and replace it with the truth. Are you with me? This is where groups or discipleship is so important. We can identify a thinking error about God or self or others and replace it with the truth. And I felt the Holy Spirit say to me, Rod, bring this to the congregation in Idaho. 5 years ago, I brought it to the congregation. I shared my story 7 years ago. And we saw 200 men and women go through those groups and find healing and wholeness for an area of their life that they were broken, that they could never get help. Now, Redwood Chapel, if there are men and women, young people in this church today, and this has been their issue, and they've been attending here for a while, but God brought a resource to them. It may be a cage drummer or a therapist or a Pure Desire group. And God said, go to this resource. And they found healing in their life, not just hell insurance. How many of you would be happy for that individual today? How many would rejoice for them, right? Boy, I sure would. Because here's what I've realized. Jesus didn't come just to save us from hell when we die. He came to help us with the hell we're living in right here and now, with the deceptiveness of sin. And for the sake of our kids and grandkids and future generations, I just felt like God was saying to me, Rodney, will you leave your church in Idaho? Would you become a missionary for this organization? I serve on their board. Would you raise your support like a missionary and go around the world and share your negative sexual history to help people? How many know that's a real enticing offer? It's like the woman at the well in John chapter 4. Come see Jesus. He knows all about me. What did he know? All her negative sexual history. Honey, you got five husbands, right? And she said, come, you got to meet this guy. He probably knows your negative sexual history too. You're going to love him. And you know what history tells us about that woman at the well? History tells us that her name was Saint Fatina. She was the first missionary to the Samaritan people. And her two boys died a martyr's death because they wouldn't renounce their faith in Jesus at the hand of Nero. Because she met the living water that day at the well. And she knew there was something more. And Jesus wasn't condemning her for her bad behavior. Jesus was elevating her and showing her a better way. That's what I love about it. And so we travel and go to churches and share. And we wrote this book, How to Talk with Your Kids About Sex. Because we just don't want to get support and healing for people. But wouldn't it be great if we had resources to help the next generation now? Wouldn't it be great if we could be proactive and not wait till they're 17 or 15 or struggle and the age is getting less and less, and that we can help parents know how to have age appropriate and be safe? I didn't feel like my mom and dad, even though they had deep faith in God, I didn't feel like they were safe to talk about in this subject, so I hid. Kind of like Adam and Eve in the garden. We hide because of shame. Jesus said things like this in Mark chapter 1, verse 15. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. Hear it this way, Jesus. Hey, how we relate in heaven, Father, Son, and I, Spirit, that kingdom, it's right here for you and I today. Repent or change the way you think about us and about yourself. Because you're worthy of love. I've come to tell you here, you're all worthy of being loved. This is what I believe is God's judgment on humanity. God's judgment on humanity is, you're all worthy of being loved. I'm dying on a cross. It's his will, the Bible says, that none perish, but that all come to repentance. The heart of God is for everyone, every lost child, those that are lost in church and those that are lost outside of church. St. Augustine, a historian in the 4th century, said, the church has people that, I forgot the quote, I'm going to move on to my next point. It was a really good one too, Jeff. Come tonight and I'll tell you this great quote by St. Augustine. I got drain bramage. And I felt the Lord prompt me to say, Rodney, travel and share the good news, how God can rewire your brain. He can change your thinking to see your worth and value and help you see the worth and value of others. Or the scripture about, well, what is eternal life? In John 17:3, Jesus said, this is eternal life. I always thought eternal life was the sinner's prayer, which is not even recorded in scripture. Jesus said here in John 17, this is eternal life. Okay, what is it? That they know you, Father, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you sent. That eternal life is found in a relationship with God. When I was in church, I used to sing this song. Jesus loves me, this I know. Now I sing it this way. I know you guys want to sing the whole song. I know this. Get the cowbell out. Let's get this thing going. Now I sing it this way. Jesus knows me, this I love. Our greatest human need, mom and dad, young people, isn't sexuality. It's intimacy. And you can be intimate without being sexuality. That's part of the trick that culture has displayed our children. And intimacy just means into me, you see. But the fear is, if you really know me, would you love me? And you know what Jesus says? Know you, we fully anticipated you. Before you were ever born, it was in our heart, Ephesians 1 says. We were going to adopt you into our family through Christ because it's what we wanted to do before the foundations of the world. I don't know what your perception is of the divine, of the Trinity of God, but I would propose today that God is exactly like Jesus. And the broken people like me in sexuality or other parts that were broken, when they came to Jesus, he was never condemning. He was always healing and showing them the better way. I like to say it this way. He didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, point the finger, hey, Rod. He came to say, Rod, take my hand. I'm going to save you. Sozo. I'm going to show you a better way. And I'm not just going to save you when I get you out of here. I'm going to start the work of saving you right here and right now. Trust me. And transformation can happen. This organization, Pure Desire, they have online groups for men and women. Here's the cool part. Because of COVID, we were already ready to start online groups. How cool is that? Through Zoom, I have groups with missionaries all over the world and pastors all over now that we can hit Zoom and we all show up on the screen and they can go through our groups. It's pretty cool. And Pure Desire is in over 800 churches, thousands of groups, and they have online groups. So if you're here today and you're saying, that's me, I'd like help, you can actually get in an online group and participate. There's a picture that we have here of the online group here. Now for churches, our organization the last few years, because more people are partnering with us, we were able to create a resource called Sexual Integrity 101. This is a resource that we want all churches to go through, men and women, so that we learn how to integrate faith in our sexuality. And this is an 8-week video course with stories and testimonies and scripture about how we can talk about human sexuality and integrate it. And more churches are taking that. And then this is the last one called Team 58. Our founder, Dr. Roberts, Vietnam fighter pilot. He had 7 stepdads growing up as a kid. A couple of them were abusive. He said, I was a rageaholic, a sexaholic, and an alcoholic. Found Christ. And he has integrated the clinical studies of the brain with what the scripture says about healthy sexuality and how pornography really creates unhealth in our relationships. And the scripture that God gave him was Isaiah 58:12. It was about restoring families and rebuilding lives. And now the over 10,000 men and women that have gone through our groups, many of them every month are saying, hey, you guys go get them. I want to join Team 58. I want to be a part of restoring families and rebuilding lives. Well, I'm going to end. This is my first ending. I got 4 minutes. Dr. Henry Cloud writes in his book, Changes That Heal. He says this, you know, there's a difference between a legalistic church, which I do not believe you are here at all, and a healthy AA group. He says, in a legalistic church, it's culturally unacceptable to have a problem. They'll call you a sinner. In a healthy AA group, if you act like you don't have a problem, they'll say you're in denial. He said, in the church, sometimes we attend and we look good, but we get worse. But in the AA group, we attend and we look worse, but we get better. And he says, I know there are good churches, and I believe this is one right here, and bad AA groups, but sometimes because of a lack of grace and truth and authenticity, some Christians have had to leave church to go find their healing in other places. But what if? What if the church becomes more like a hospital where we participate in the healing work of Jesus? And what if churches get resourced with tools and resources to help men and women find healing and wholeness in these arenas? So today, I would say to you, if you're here, I'm not going to make you raise your hand, walk down this aisle. There's too many women. We don't have enough room for all the women down here. Just know you're not alone and that God sees your struggle. I identify with struggle, and there are people and resources that are there to help you. Now, here's what I want to leave you with today. I didn't forget, Corey. They got a prompter right here. Coming in May, there's going to be a video series that's fantastic. It's called the Conquer Series. And I would like every dad that's here, every granddad, every high schooler to come to this, because you're going to learn how pornography isn't just a moral issue, it's a brain issue, and it affects the brain. And how we as men in our congregation, maybe some of us have navigated this like me, but as men in our congregation, we can help the next generation have healthier conversations about this. So I would love every man that's here, to put this on your calendar, mark this date, and show up for the sake of your children. I met a six-month-old today, Levi. I don't know if his mom's here or not, but I met him. He's a cute little guy. And I just looked at him and thought of my grandson, and I thought, they're worth it. I hope they're Christians that have courage, that won't just remain silent, but stand up in this culture and say, there's a better way. I'll own my story. And that's what I felt the Holy Spirit asked me to do as a gray-haired elder, as a tribal elder. You know what a tribal elder is? Gray hair, no hair, or you color your hair once a month. You're a tribal elder. Wouldn't it be beautiful if some of us seasoned believers could have Jesus heal our shame and own our story and offer it as a gift to society, to the church, to say to our kids, there's a better way. You're worthy of love. And mom and dad, we can train you how to be the safest person and how to share age-appropriate information with your kids. Don't go home and share everything you've ever done wrong in this arena with your kids. We're going to help you know how to educate you. Brené Brown says it this way: if you deny your story, it defines you. But when you own it, you can write a brave new ending. And I say with Jesus, let's write some brave new endings. In a culture where there's confusion, I say yes to partnering with you to bring healing and wholeness in this arena. Thank you for letting me share my story. God bless you.
Come on.
Thank you, Jeff.
Thanks, brother. Rodney, thank you for your authenticity. Thank you for your ability to share what can be a challenging topic in such a winsome and approachable way. I appreciate that. I look forward to hearing from you and Tracy tonight. It'll be a great time together. Before we dismiss, though, we want to have an opportunity to say thank you to Jesus for the work that he has done in uniting us together under his blood by the work that he has done through the cross. And we do that together on a weekly basis by taking the Lord's Supper. And if you did not pick up the elements of communion, our ushers will bring them down at this time. You can just raise your hand and they'll be happy to deliver to you a little packet that has both a little wafer and some juice in it. The significance is not in the taste. The significance is in the symbolism and what this represents. And when we take communion together and we open this packet and we receive this bread, we are thanking Jesus for his body, which was broken for us. And when we take the cup and we drink the juice, we are remembering the new covenant that has been made in his blood on our behalf. And there is a beautiful unity that takes place here in the room when we all have the opportunity to partake together. So if you are a follower of Jesus, and if you have made a commitment to walk with him, to follow him, then we invite you to join us as we take the Lord's Supper together. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we ask this blessing over our church family. God, may we recognize not only the work that you have done for us individually, but the work that you have done for us corporately that makes us a family, that unites us together in the work of your Son, Jesus. May our hearts and our attention be thankful for you today. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. When you're ready to partake, feel free to partake of the Lord's Supper. Thank you. Amen. Thank you, Don. It was beautiful. As Rodney and Tracy make their way out to the lobby, I want to remind you and encourage you to stop by their table out there. You can pick up a copy of this book, How to Talk with Your Kids About Sex. I also want to encourage you to come back this evening. We're having a parent seminar in the Williams Chapel this evening. We do not have any more space for childcare, so if you do need to find childcare for this evening, we encourage you to find a babysitter and do that because our childcare is filled up, both for the nursery and for the elementary age, but we would love to have you come back. And this is not just for young families, it's not just for parents, it's for grandparents, it's for anybody that has a desire to help create this the healthy culture around the topic of sexuality. So we encourage you to come back and be a part of that at 6 p.m. this evening. Go ahead and stand with me if you would. When you think about victory in this area, I think about the opportunity to think about Jude's doxology, which says, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to present you blameless before the Father with great power and great joy. To the only God our Father be power and dominion both now and forevermore." Amen. Amen. As you dismiss, there are ushers at the table, or excuse me, at the doors that will receive our retiring offering, which will go to support the ministry of Pure Desire. So thank you for being a part of our time today. God bless you. Have a great day.